Hey guys, Heyman6307 here, and I am finally reviewing Rugrats Go Wild. But before I do, let me point out a few things. One, for those who don't know, this is a crossover film between the Rugrats and the Wild Thornberries. And I'm sorry, but I have no legitimate exposure to the Wild Thornberries outside of this film. So I apologize if I get anything wrong about these characters. I'm sorry, but the clips in the film that I got are high-pitched, so if that bothers you, I'm sorry. It doesn't bother me, but if you don't like the high pitch, I don't know what to tell you. And lastly, I'm wearing an orange shirt. I was going to wear yellow, but I decided to do orange since I haven't worn that one yet. But with that short nonsense out of the way, let's just get started. So unlike the first two films, this film doesn't open with a legitimate film parody. It starts with the babies pretending to be on an adventure in the jungle with Tommy as Nigel Thornberry.
Come along, faithful viewers, on our journey through the rainforest. As we search for that rare and unusable creature, the three-toed sloth.
However, a tiger approaches.
And because I'm an expert, I say, everybody, into the truck!
Well, I would hope you would run, because if Shiva from The Walking Dead is any indication, I would not want to piss that tiger off. Just look at these poor bastards. So basically, tigers will fuck you up. So where was I? Oh yeah!
I can hear the tiger's running feet, see his sharp teeth, and I feel a cool breeze!
Okay, seriously, all but one of the films I've reviewed have shown a baby's ass, and I would like that to stop! So the babies encounter a
crocodile!
Okay. And Tommy distracts it by throwing a ball at it, but of course it doesn't work long.
But that was my onlyest cue toy!
That freaking failed!
What? What the fuck?
Jesus, Chucky! So the babies try to run through a swamp, only to get caught in quicksand. But of course, right as the tiger is about to maul them, it's revealed that it was all a fantasy, which I think I already spoiled. And the tiger is actually Angelica's pet cat, Fluffy, because when the fuck did she get a cat? But Angelica being Angelica, she starts insulting and making fun of the babies. And just for future reference, the crocodile was in actuality Spike. And no, I can't confirm if Tommy was specifically meaning a crocodile or alligator. I did not read zoo books as a kid, nor am I Steve Irwin. May he rest in peace. But back to the movie. Tommy catches an episode of Nigel Thornberry's show on TV. Can someone who actually watched The Wild Thornberrys confirm or deny the fact that Nigel had a show in-universe? So we cut to inside the house where all of the adults are scrambling trying to get ready for a week-long getaway. Christ, I thought my in-laws scrambling trying to get away for a weekend was bad.
Well, I'm gonna use the whole 7 kid-free days to reshape my physique.
Could happen. The Earth was created in 6.
I fucking love Betty. So we cut to the dock where we actually see that Susie is actually a main character in the film for once. And Angelica decides to sing. Wait, what?
Dresses and shoes are the only things that I'll share. That's my rule.
Oh no.
I wonder if it's too late to call my mommy.
I feel your pain, Susie. But the cruise ship everyone wanted to board sails off without them. Ain't that fun? But that's when we discover...
Captain Stew, at your service! I'm aboard for 7 fun-filled days on the SS Nancy. No fancy package tour. Just the thrill of the open sea, the smell of the salt air, and the joy of close friends and family.
Are you serious?
Okay, let's do a quick recap. Okay. You have you, your wife, your 2 kids, your pet dog. Then you have your brother, his wife, and his daughter. And then you have the best character in the series, her husband, and their 2 kids. And then you have Chaz, Kira, and their 2 kids. And a kid who y'all are practically babysitting. That's 17 people. And none of those kids are at least 10 years or older. Like, most of them are babies, and 2 of them are 3-year-olds. Y'all are going on a 7-day vacation, not on a fancy cruise ship, but on a fucking piece of shit boat that is in serious disrepair? Stu, what the actual hell is wrong with you? That's not a vacation! Where the fuck do you expect them to sleep? What are they gonna eat? What if somebody gets sick or injured? Where are they gonna use the bathroom? I can't even process how stupid that is. The fuck this shit. I need a fucking break.
The next day.
That's not even a joke. How I do these reviews is I watch the movies beforehand before I write my review. Stu's logic was so bad, I actually quit watching for the day and then waited till the next day to continue watching. It was really that fucking stupid. So, we cut to Stu's raggedy piece of shit boat, where...
Well, okay. Time to get naked.
Oh, you are fucking kidding me. Hold on. Rewind a minute.
We're all together.
What if that knocked one of the kids off of the boat, Stu? You fucking purple-haired idiot! So, after Drew rightfully takes control of the boat, Dee Dee gets a signal on the boat's radio. However...
Could you send a rescue boat right away? Where's the squalid little boat in the middle of the ocean?
Huh? My muscles are atrophying as we speak! Well, we paid for spa treatments, and I'm not missing a single one.
Huh? Hang on a sec, Mom. I'm picking up some lame-o soap opera.
Welp, we've officially entered the crossover portion of this movie. So with the Thornberry kids, the oldest child, Debbie, is being a bit of a bitch for no reason. Then it starts to rain, which apparently is a problem for Donnie.
And you know how he likes mud.
Can someone who's actually watched The Wild Thornberries confirm if Donnie's actually this funny in the show? So, back with the Rugrats family. We see that the rain is affecting them, and Betty, of course, being the responsible parent, wants to get the kids below deck. However... Rats! Stu! Why? So, things get worse. And they have to start hauling ass.
It's a 40-foot wall of water!
We're gonna need a bigger boat.
Everyone get below!
I'm just saying it now. Whatever happens next, that's all on Stu! How the fuck did this guy end up with Betty? Well, first of all, that's your fault for having your damn phone out. Secondly, your dumb ass seriously nearly jumped overboard for a fucking phone? Thirdly, Betty casually being the best character some more. So everybody manages to get below deck and... Let's just remember that had Betty not been there, they would all probably be dead. So after resurfacing... upside down...
Well, this is how he came in.
No!
God damn it, Chaz.
I think everybody's stopping.
Out of my way.
Where you going?
Go, Charlotte!
Charlotte, don't! It's a rental!
Okay, but quick question. Why is Charlotte trying to be a badass instead of... Oh, I don't know. Betty! Also, Stu, you're worried about this being a rental now! Fuck off! So, as everybody tries to get out of the sinking ship, Betty does a rescue mission to get Dill's binky. Okay, I'll give her props for actually being able to recover the damn thing, but legitimate question, why did she have to do that? Wait a minute, where's Spike? We've established since the first Rugrats movie that you cannot kill Spike. Don't try to pull that shit on me. But naturally, Betty is the responsible one and has a life raft, and they get on it just as the boat sinks.
I can't help feeling partially responsible.
Stu, do us all a favor. Stop talking.
There's got to be a morning after. If we can hold on through the night, I know we can.
Stu, do us all a favor. Start talking. But as we sit through this, Spike is alive, oh thank God. And he knocks Angelica's Cynthia doll off of the raft. Okay, Angelica, look, I'll admit I feel sorry for you, but why the fuck would you put the thing on the edge of the raft?
There, there, princess. We've all lost something today. Why,
I lost my cell phone with 100 free minutes. And Daddy lost his favorite sun visor, and Uncle Stu lost all our respect.
If I was any of these people, I wouldn't let my children anywhere near this fucker. So the next day... Okay, how in the fuck did the Cynthia get to the island? That is such fucking bullshit. I'm willing to believe that they happened to get on the island where the thornberries are. Okay? I'm willing to believe that. But I am not willing to believe that that Cynthia doll made it to this fucking island. That is fucking bullshit. So anyway, everybody wakes up and realizes that they are on an island. So right when they realize they're quote-unquote alone, because keep in mind they don't know that the thornberries are there, the life raft drifts out to sea and pops. Great.
How soon before we all turn cannibal? I have to get out of here!
So, Swiss Family DeVille, he's not.
I fucking love Betty. But anyway, on the other side of the island, Nigel and his wife, whose name I forgot, return to the kids and leave. And then Eliza leaves. So meanwhile, with the Rugrats and their families, Betty continues to be the best.
Okie doke, kids. You play here while the mommies and daddies try to ward off the specter of doom!
But then Angelica continues to be a brat, and decides to have a musical number. What is with these movies and their goddamn musical numbers? So the adults try to figure out a plan.
It's obvious. The first thing to do is make a signal fire.
You know what else is obvious? You're an idiot.
Yes, he is. But an argument ensues, which causes Betty to continue to be the best character. And for that reason, the adults nominate Betty as leader of the group, and she assigns Stu to watch the babies. Personally, if I was Betty, I'd throw Stu into the ocean, but I guess we'll let him live. So after overhearing everything, Tommy decides to take the babies to find Nigel Thornberry to see if he can help them get home.
I'm going to build a signal fire that will have us off this island in no time. Let's see, gum, my special writes upside down pen and disposable razor. Great, I can chew, shave, and write about it on my head.
Okay, I'll give Stu that. That scene is a mood. So Angelica sends Spike to find the babies, and while sulking around, she accidentally comes across Debbie and the Thornberry's pet monkey, Darwin. No, I don't know why they have a pet monkey. Can someone explain that to me, please? So Angelica tries to schmooze up to Debbie under the name Angelitiki. Okay, that's actually clever. But she tries to schmooze up to her in an attempt to learn to be bossy, and this causes Darwin to run away scared. So meanwhile, with Tommy's group, we have another musical number.
This place is different than our own backyard. I hope we haven't gone too far. If summer's new and we haven't a clue. I just saw the butterfly turn blue. This is a strange and mysterious place. Lots of yummy buggies.
However, after getting a possible lead on Nigel, the gang accidentally leaves Chucky behind. Meanwhile, we see Darwin trying to tell Eliza about Angelica. However, they spot Spike, and...
Hey! Could you give a dog a little warning? I'm trying to do my business here.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
You know, it's funny. For a minute there, I thought I actually heard you talking to me. You talking to me? Are you talking to me?
Yeah, I can talk to animals. It's a long story.
Well, it's not the voice I would have given him, but I like it. So the three introduce themselves, and Spike informs Eliza and Darwin about his situation, and they agree to help him. Well, more Eliza than Darwin. Okay, can someone who's watched The Wild Thornberries confirm if Darwin is always like this? Because legitimately, I don't know. Meanwhile, with Chucky, he ends up falling in mud and actually manages to wash his clothes by himself. Good on you, pal. But while doing so, he encounters Donnie, thinking he's his reflection.
Oh, you're just my reflection. How you doing, Chucky?
You're gonna boo, quack, quack.
Oh, hi, Matt. So Donnie takes Chucky's clothes, forcing him to wear Donnie's shorts. We're doing this? Like we're doing this? This isn't even part of my notes that I'm reading off of to record this. Like, I'm literally just now realizing. What the fuck? Who came up with that? But back to Tommy and the gang. They finally find Nigel. However.
Children, stay right there. I'm coming down. Not the way I intended.
She called me Mister.
Silly Billy. I'm only this many years old.
Shit!
So, back to Spike's group. They come across Siri, a clouded leopard that Nigel and his wife are looking for. However, Spike decides to start antagonizing her through a musical number. Which, normally I would complain about. But truth be told, this song is a fucking bop. And I'd play the whole thing, if not for fucking copyright. So enjoy this one fucking clip.
Those fancy pants, it's just her feline arrogance, flaunting their collars with tinkly bells. She thinks her little box don't smell.
Whoa, man, who cut the cheese? Was that you, baby? You may want to re-examine your diet.
But after that, Spike sort of lets it slip to Siri that the babies are out there, and Siri decides to go try to hunt them and kill them. Are we really rehashing wild animals trying to kill the babies from the first one? Really? Speaking of rehashing from the first movie, Chucky encounters monkeys, and either this is serious continuity with the movie, or he's just being a pussy. Either one works. He actually tries to hide from the monkeys. But after discovering that three bigger monkeys are bullying a smaller monkey, he actually stands up to them and becomes a badass. Wow, Chucky's managed to be a badass in all three movies. I literally just now realized.
You big monkeys go away! You was little monkeys yourselves once. Probably. So just go away and leave this little monkey alone. Shoot!
So meanwhile, man, I say that a lot, Debbie and Angelica bond, and Debbie tries to quote-unquote teach her how to be bossy. And by teach, I mean makes Angelica her little slave. But when Angelica and Debbie learn that Siri is after the babies, Angelica steals the Thornberry submarine, because they just have a submarine, and while trying to figure out how to drive it...
Little star.
So the babies and Nigel are...
I'm a kangaroo. I'm a froggy. And I'm frogging.
But they end up encountering Siri anyway.
Does Kitty want a mousie? Does Kitty want to dress up in dolly clothes and take a ride in Nanny's flat?
Kitty gave me a boo-boo.
But Donnie comes in being a fucking badass, and he and Chucky swap clothes. And after a series of shenanigans, they end up in some kind of cave. And when hope seems lost, Angelica saves them. With a pointless Star Wars reference. So meanwhile, the adults are doing well without Stu.
Drew, there's no longer a ringing in my ears from constant cell phone usage. Oh, isn't this paradise?
Sure is, honey.
Honey!
And encounter Donnie, who they believe ate Chucky. And while chasing him, they encounter Mrs. Thornberry. And then the great ruiner of everything shows off a radio he built. And of course he reveals he fucked up by letting Angelica watch the kids.
This is very strange. I feel like this has happened before.
Really? But after finding out the babies are in the submarine, Debbie reveals that the Thornberry's van is sunk. And after successfully reaching the babies, shit goes wrong, Nigel hits his head, he regains his memory, finds out that they have almost no oxygen left, so the adults on the surface have to raise the van out of the water. But after finding out that there's a rip in the tube that kept the van on the water, they find the life raft from earlier. I thought that thing popped! But anyway, Spike volunteers to get it in one of the most fucking badass scenes I've ever seen.
She found your boat, Spike! They can use it to patch the combi!
I'll get it!
Spike, no! The wings are too big!
Hey! This is Spike you're talking to! I paddled my way! The more tennis balls than I can count! If I could count,
But I'm afraid you won't make it!
Sure I will! And if I don't, well, no one's gonna say that old down Spike didn't try his best! You only go around once in this crazy mixed up life! Whoa! Not cats. They get 9 lives. While dogs have to cram 7 years into one. Now that fight!
And after successfully getting the raft, they successfully raise the van, and just in time, because the submarine has run out of oxygen. And they are saved. And after everyone reunites, the movie ends with everyone going on a proper vacation, and as the credits roll, we see various pictures from said vacation. This movie is... okay. Yeah, it wasn't the best thing I've ever seen. And to be honest, it is the weakest of the Rugrats movie trilogy. It's still a fun movie, but it doesn't have any scenes that really tug at my heartstrings like the first two movies. Plus, this one doesn't shake up the status quo of either show, which I guess makes sense. And if y'all couldn't tell, Stu kinda pissed me off in this. Another thing that annoys me, Siri got no kind of resolution. But as per usual, Betty proves to be my favorite character. And to be honest, I'm tempted to watch the Rugrats series again just for Betty, because she honestly has done nothing in these films but prove that she is the best character in the fucking series. Also, I do like how this one doesn't focus on any specific character. So in order of how I rank the films, I'd rank them Rugrats in Paris, the Rugrats movie, and Rugrats Go Wild. And with all that finally said, I'm gonna wrap it up here. And until next time, Hey Man is out. Peace.
Marianne, perhaps I could lure out the leopard by imitating its mating call.
Okay, so we're not normal.
Normal's boring! Don't be normal!